2015, they tell you that the recent estimate beta for a stock is 1.24, and they tell you to adjust it. The reason for this is that between historical data and actual data, you should always take historical beta, sorry, not data, because it takes out the skewness. So the way the book adjusts it is using the actual data, the actual beta, sorry, multiplied by 2/3, and then you multiply 1/3 by 1, being this is a standard deviation, and it gives 1/16. And then later gives you a formula which tells you would use, because it's a formula you estimated, which is this. You just plug in the data, and it gives you the same, confirming 1/16. Pretty straightforward.
That's 81.
That's me.
Calculating a covariance in this one, so they give a bunch of the numbers are given, and you just plug them in to find what the covariance of A and B would be, which is going to be 336. And then to find of the portfolio, you have to divide by the standard deviations, which were 31.369.28. So 336 divided by that gives you 0.155. And then for this one, you're calculating the beta, which we know is cap n, so it's expected return on expected return minus the risk-free rate, and return on the market minus the risk-free rate, and all these numbers were given as well, so it's 12/8, which is your beta is 1.5, which is pretty good.
Test question. If the beta goes up, what happens to the expected return? If the beta goes up, what happens to the expected return? If the beta goes up, what happens to the cost of the equity? If the beta goes up, what happens to the cost of the equity? Goes up. If the beta goes down, what happens to the expected return? But if the beta goes down, what happens to the expected cost of the equity?
Exactly.
And if the beta goes down and the expected cost of the equity goes down, or the expected return on the equity goes down, what happens to the value of the stock? It's the earnings per share divided by the expected return or the equity cost of capital. If the expected return or the equity cost of capital goes down, what happens to the value of the share? Got it. Okay, good. All right, who's got 9.1?
Matt just did that.
I did both.
Oh, you did it? Okay.
Yeah, I did both of them.
Anybody else got any we want to take us through? Anybody else? So I got a no. The whole class doesn't have any problems. Most of the class doesn't have any problems. Okay. Thanks, Matt. Can you do it? Anybody almost done? Anybody happy that are ready to go? Yes or no? You have one almost done?
Yeah, pretty much.
Okay, cool. So can you put it up? Anybody else have anybody that are almost done?
Yeah, I've come from chapter 3.
Yeah, go for it. Anybody else have any that's almost done? Okay, the answer is either yes or no.
No.
Okay.
Almost.
Thank you. Okay, so I'll do this one over here. Can you move the camera over here? Yeah, just look at the viewfinder and see if I'm on. I'm over here. Can you see the whole thing there?
Yeah, now we're good.
Okay, in chapter 3, the margin example, when you're calculating the margin percentage, it's going to be the net worth of the equity that you put in divided by the market value of the securities. Your net worth or your equity is 6,000 divided by the 10,000, which is the value of the portfolio. So the 10,000 minus the 6,000 is the 4,000 that you borrow. Okay? You have a loan from a broker dealer, you borrow, it's going to cost you 8-9%. We want to use margin because we can buy more securities. Problem is we buy more securities, if we're right, then our return on equity goes through the roof. If we're wrong, our return on equity goes through the floor. And eventually, we're going to get a margin call. Okay? You usually put in 50% initial margin. The margin calls usually start at 50%. Okay? So here you got your assets, which is 10 grand. The loan is 4, the equity is 6, so the total is 10. Your initial margin is going to be the 6,000, which is your equity that you put in divided by the 10%. So your initial margin is 60%. It's above the 50, and it's way above the 30, so no margin call. Stock falls to $70. Now the stock value is 77 grand, your loan is still 4, and your equity is 3. So the equity divided by the 7,000, your margin is now 43%. No margin call because you didn't hit the 30. Okay. So the maintenance margin, in this is your equity equals 100p because you're trying to figure out the price at which the stock can fall before I get a margin call, minus the $4,000 loan. So your equity, $100 to the p minus the $4,000 loan. So your margin percentage is going to be 100p minus the 4k divided by the 100p. So here's how you do it, because the last time we did this, we skip through the algebra, okay? And I think you gotta really know how to do the algebra in a lot of these things. So you got 100p minus the 4k divided by 100p equals 0.3, which is your maintenance margin. So what you do is you multiply the 0.3 by the 100p, which gives you 30p. You bring the 30p over here and you bring the 4k over there. So it's 100 minus 30. Is going to give you equals 4K. 100P minus 30P is going to give you 70P. You got the 4K. Then you take the sorry. Then you take the 70, bring it over, and it's 4K divided by 70. That's going to be $57.14.
Where's the K come? What K?
It's for it's $4,000.
The K just means that. Oh,
yeah.
I thought it was another variable.
No, the K is 1,000.
I was like, what?
Instead of writing out all the
words. Yeah, no, I got it.
Okay, sorry about that. So it's the 4K divided by the 70 gives you the $57.14. Okay, so you just have to know how to do that.
So with the 57, the stock
it's going to be asked, it can fall to that. Once it goes to 57.14, you're going to get a margin call. Okay, because you already set it at 0.3. Okay. Who's ready to do one? We're almost done. I'm going to do value at risk really quick. Value at risk comes up all the time. It's what is the risk that's at value in the portfolio? We don't care about the whole distribution, we just care about the odds. Quintile. Okay. And the way that you would do it is the standard deviation.
Why do we only care about
the? Because that's where we're. This is the max. This is the loss.
Okay.
And that's the loss. That's the tail risk. Okay. So we want to figure out how much that tail risk is going to be. So what you want to do is you want to the value at risk is going to be the mean minus the 12.65. Okay. Standard deviation. So what you're doing is you sort from high to low, and the bottom fifth percentile is your is the loss, is the, what you're trying to calculate, is what that value is. You can also use the t statistic to figure that out too. And the t statistic is just the differences in the mean divided by the standard deviation divided by the square root of n. Now you can see that the t statistic here is 1.3. Is that statistically significant at 1.3?
No.
It's pretty significant. I mean, it's not 2, but it's significant enough, and depending on your confidence level, it's statistically significant too. And I'll get into VAR a little bit more later. Okay, go ahead.
Okay, so this is chapter 5 for CFM 3 and 4. And I'm just going to do this for stock vex, because I ran out of room. So for stock x and y, for stock x, find the expected rate of return and standard deviation. So I have the chart here with all the information. This is the probability of the state of the market. And then this is, these numbers, negative 0.2, 0.18, and 0.5, is the cooling period return. To find the expected earnings for stock X, that equals the sum of probability of stock market state multiplied by the holding period return. Okay, so that's 0.2 times 0.-2 plus 0.5 times 0.18 times plus 0.3 times 0.5 or 0.5. Okay, and that will equal to -4 plus 0.09 plus 0.15 equals 2.2 or 20% expected return. To get the standard deviation, so this is the equation for the standard deviation squared, which is the sum of the probability of the stock market state multiplied by the holding period return, take away the expected earnings, which is this number, squared. So that would be 0.2 multiplied by negative 0.2, take away 0.2 squared plus negative 0.5 times 0.18, take away 0.2 squared plus 0.3 times 0.5, take away 2 squared. And so if you calculate all that, you get 0.0125 plus 0.005 plus 0 equals 0.0175. Now to get the standard deviation, we're going to square root 0.0175, and we get a standard deviation of 0.1323.
Okay, so take questions of this, and really quickly, test question. If I wanted to calculate the coefficient of variation for the portfolio, how would I do that? What would I do if I wanted to calculate the coefficient of variation for this portfolio?
Are you taking regression?
No, no, no. The coefficient of variation. What's the equation? What's the coefficient of variation? Nope, what's the coefficient of variation? It was on the first list. So some of you have seen it like 4 times. It's not the Fisher equation. What's the coefficient of variation?
Isn't it?
Nope. Standard deviation divided by the expected return. Write that down and memorize it. What's the Sharpe ratio? Can I calculate the Sharpe ratio from this?
Yes.
Now how do I calculate it? What's the Sharpe ratio? You wrote it down on the pretest.
Yes.
Expect the return.
Is that the one with
what's the Sharpe ratio?
Isn't that the put the risk free rate in the return?
It's the expected return minus the risk free rate divided by standard deviation. Okay. And what does that also give you? The Sharpe ratio.
Cap down.
It does give you the basis of the cap up, doesn't it give you the slope of the capital allocation left? Yeah. I'm going to ask you all a bunch of these questions. Bring those problems. Bring me your stock, bring me your portfolios too.
Wednesday?
Yeah, I want to see the portfolios that you have set. And then I'll give you a new spreadsheet that'll allow you to be able to back test the portfolio. And I'll give you another one that'll allow you to be able to optimize it. So we'll do a couple more permutations, but I need the base portfolio.
We want to do our weighting factors based on their like, equity. How the risk high?
Oh, really? What's the calculation?
It has 17.
Yeah, how do you calculate the weights based on debt to equity ratio? Yeah, but the scaling factors, the weighting factors are by revenue or by some other scaling factors. How do you get to a dollar amount to put in there based on debt to equity?
We need a dollar last time, we can't use the numerical.
No, if we got
the times by the stock price.
No, because debt to equity ratios are going to be mean this year. It's not going to kick out. You can try it, see what happens. But I think there's a different type of calculation that you need to do to be able to figure out.